Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? For the past month or so, there has been a star that has generated quite a bit of talk among both the professional and amateur astronomy communities. So the real question would come down to, what happened in the year 1380? And I know you might be thinking, wait, what? Well, the star Betelgeuse is about 640 light years away. So at 640 light years away, if you take 2020 and subtract 640 for the speed of light, that would put you at the year 1380. So what happened in the year 1380? Well, Charles V of France died, and then Charles VI of France was crowned, who was only 12 years old, and then he declared that there would be no more taxes forever. Not sure how he did that, but he was 12, so he must not have known that death and taxes are forever. But anyway, I'm getting off track. The point is that Betelgeuse, if it exploded in the year 1380, that light would get to us in 2020. But astronomers say that's probably not the case. Although Betelgeuse is rather old, and it's kind of bloated, as you can see here. See, it's kind of a big star. This comes from ALMA. It's not very round. It's got light spots. It's got dark spots. You know, kind of like your skin starts to do when you start getting a little bit older. But the problem is that it's probably not quite old enough to actually go supernova yet. At least that's not what astronomers think is happening. However, it is getting a whole lot dimmer and noticeably dimmer. How much dimmer? I pulled up a smoothed light curve for Betelgeuse going back about 30 years. And as you can see, it would generally stay in this range from about magnitude 1 to up to like a half, really about 0.42 is what it's typically at. And then it would go down and up and down and up and down, maybe drop a little lower here and there. But then you look recently and that dropped off a cliff. It got really, really, really low. It's well within the first magnitude, starting to hit into second magnitude range. So if we look at another set of photos, this is how Betelgeuse looked in the sky about a week or so, actually earlier this week. I think I took this on about the 5th of January. And you can see it's pretty similar to Bellatrix, not quite as dim as safe down here. And the belt stars look remarkably similar. However, they are quite a bit different because if you flip over, you can see these are the actual magnitudes of these stars. But look at how Betelgeuse is. Normally, it's almost as bright as Rigel, and it's not. It's usually just a couple tenths of a degree off of Rigel, and it's much, much fainter. It's pretty darn close to what Bellatrix is, like there. I mean, you can see that. The other cool thing is Betelgeuse is really red. That other photo I showed you before showed you how red it was, but the reason why we know it's red is because it is a red giant star. The spectral type is M, so it's definitely a red giant star. It's also very cool, and here's why it's probably gotten so dim over the past month or so, because really astronomers started noticing this back in October, and then it really got very dim in December and has dropped even more. But what's happened is that Betelgeuse goes through apparently two phases of its variability, and one is about 425 days long and the other one is about 6 years long, and they both seem to be coinciding. So that's very likely what is happening here. Astronomers also seem to think that January might be the month where it kind of dips into its lowest and then starts to pull back up. So you've got several months of seeing Betelgeuse in the sky. And if I even go forward a little bit in time, we can see how we can go all the way out into like, not quite April. Maybe April even, late April, 9 o'clock, you can still see Betelgeuse there up in the sky. So you've got about 3 months to check this out, at least in the evening sky, before it kind of goes back behind where the sun is going to be at, and, be able to see what this particular star is doing. Now, I would strongly encourage you to look at it, number one, naked eye, obviously. If you have the ability to take some photos, a cell phone takes remarkably good photos these days of the night sky if you put it on something and are able to do a timed exposure. If not, if you happen to have a camera that will do a timed exposure, even if you get 5 or 10 seconds, that's going to get you enough that you can at least see kind of these main stars in Betelgeuse. Take that and then start recording those and see how the brightness changes over time. Make sure you take the exact same length and exposure photo. The other thing that you could do is look at it through a telescope or binoculars. If you do use a telescope, don't use one that has got a large aperture. And the reason why I say that is because it's still fairly bright. I mean, it's a first, even maybe second magnitude star at this point. That's still easily visible in just about anything, including binoculars that are, you know, 40 or 50 millimeters in aperture. As such, the smaller aperture actually helps to preserve the color that you see. And right now, especially from a naked eye perspective, Betelgeuse does seem very deep in color. It's got that really deep orange reddish kind of thing happening. So in order to be able to see that well, less aperture is actually going to help you. If you only have a larger telescope, that's okay too. You can make an aperture mask. So just take a piece of cardboard, cut a hole in it, and then use that to only allow maybe, you know, 50, 60, 70 millimeters of light through into your telescope to cut down on how much is actually hitting. And that way you'll be able to see that better. You can also use that aperture mask when you look at the moon if you don't happen to have a filter. So there's a trick for you as well. But definitely go check out Betelgeuse right now in the constellation of Orion towards the south, a couple hours after sunset, and see what's happening with this variable star that is putting on quite an interesting dip of a light show right now. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.